Hi, everyone. Thank you for joining me today. My name is Jennifer Curry. I'm a shareholder in the Baker Donaldson Baltimore office. And today we're going to be talking about retaliation claims that survive a False Claims Act lawsuit. Basically, what happens when you have a False Claims Act that the false claims actually end up going away, but you still have a retaliation claim left that you need to defend. I work in the labor and employment group with Baker Donaldson, and I specialize in particular with working with healthcare providers on dealing with employment issues, employment litigation, and that's exactly where False Claims Act retaliation claims fall into, is frankly employment litigation. So with that, we will get into a little bit of the housekeeping rules and or guidelines that we're going to talk about to, you know, getting into today. First of all, there's going to be a question and answer box that we ask you to submit your questions to. Since I'm the only one presenting today, there's a good chance I won't be able to get to all of your questions, but I will be able to answer them by email after the presentation. So please do submit your questions, and I will get back to you as quickly as possible after the presentation today. We're going to ask, you know, please provide your feedback. There's going to be a survey at the end of the webinar. We really want to hear what you have to say and what you think, so that way we know how to make these presentations better for you in the future. There's also going to be a PDF of the presentation that's going to be made available to you in the resource list and emailed out to anyone who attended the presentation today in the days following, in the next few days. And finally, we're going to ask you to connect with us. Baker Donaldson has a few social media links, including Twitter and LinkedIn, and it keeps you up to date, provides you all the information and all the topics that we're talking about and giving presentations on. So it's really helpful and important for employers to keep up to date, and so we make sure we do that as much as possible. So please join us on Twitter and LinkedIn. So with all that, let's get started. In today's agenda, we're going to be talking first about the basics of the FCA whistleblower protections and how those have expanded in recent years. We're going to talk about the basic elements of FCA retaliation. We're going to go through some FCA retaliation case law so you see how the new standards and elements are being applied by the courts right now. And then finally, we're going to get into some best practices for dealing with whistleblowers and their complaints. So, the basics of FCA whistleblower protections. The FCA has actually been around for quite a long time, but in 1986, Congress amended the act to give it some stronger key TAM provisions, allowing for relators to recover significantly more than they were allowed to recover before, up to 15 to 25% in any cases that involved government intervention. Then, you know, it kind of remained stagnant for a while like that until 2009, when Congress passed several amendments to the act to strengthen the ability of private citizens to take whistleblower actions and be protected from retaliation. You had the Fraud Enforcement and Recovery Act, the Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act that had several FCA pieces that came along with it, and then the Dodd-Frank Consumer Protection Act. And all of those worked together to add various protections for whistleblowers, to add language to the retaliation piece of the act itself, and made it much easier for employees to claim retaliation and much more difficult for employers to identify when somebody was making an internal complaint and how to best defend that. So the big question is, why should you care about whistleblowers? First, they are the most common catalyst for government investigations, and we're going to look at some statistics in a little bit just to show what I mean by that. They also can create FCA knowledge, meaning that when a whistleblower makes a complaint, that puts you, the company, on notice that there could be fraud or false claims being made to the government. And so once you have that knowledge, any behavior that goes beyond that makes you liable because you are on notice or have knowledge of that behavior. If you mishandle a whistleblower, maybe you mistreat them in some way, you don't take their complaint seriously, whatever it might be, it increases the risk that that there's going to be a government investigation initiated. You know, in particular, if you have an employee who complains internally and they are later terminated, that triggers the government into thinking that maybe there's something more to their claim than they otherwise would have thought. And then also you have retaliation against whistleblowers themselves. That itself creates liability, even if there's no false claim. And we'll get into this a little bit more, but one of the biggest misconceptions among employers, and this relates to both False Claims Act retaliation cases, but any other type of retaliation case, like whether that's under Title VII or the ADA or anything else that you can think of, even if the underlying claim is shown to not be legitimate or not have any basis, if an employee claims race or gender discrimination, for example, even if there is no race or gender discrimination found, they can still have a retaliation claim if they're able to show that they were retaliated against for complaining about race or gender discrimination. The same thing can happen here. Even if somebody files a False Claims Act and attaches a retaliation component to their claim, if the false claim piece of it or the fraud piece of it is found to be not with basis, and not having a claim, even if that claim ultimately goes away, the person can still pursue a retaliation case against the employer for saying, essentially, I complained, and even if my complaint didn't have any legitimacy, you still terminated me, and so you retaliated against me. And in fact, I have two active pieces of litigation right now where the only piece left in each of those litigation matters is retaliation, where the false claims or the fraud, the original fraud claims have been otherwise dismissed. You also need to keep in mind that there are most states out there have their own versions of the false claims law. And a lot of them, frankly, are even more stringent and strict, not just on the false claims piece of it, but on the whistleblower piece. So, again, you know, relating back to the cases that I have now, both of those involve not only retaliation claims under the federal law, but retaliation claims under their applicable state laws as well. So you need to keep in mind that it's not just the federal law that could come to bite you, although most state false claims laws are based on the Federal False Claims Act. So some numbers just generally about key TAM matters. Since the passage of the key TAM provisions and the time that we've been keeping data on all of this, relators have initiated a majority of false claims actions, 71%, in fact, of all new matters from 1987 to 2018 were brought forward by relators. During that same time period, the government recovered just over $59 billion. But the interesting piece here is that whistleblowers were responsible for $42.5 billion, or 72% of that recovery, which is a huge number. And in 2018 alone, last year alone, whistleblowers initiated 84% of new matters and accounted for 73% of the government's recoveries. So it's not even an over-exaggeration to say, most of these False Claims Act cases that we're seeing are initiated and pursued, or at least triggered, by relators. So here's just some numbers just to give you some more perspective. And this is a graph showing all of the new false claims matters that have been opened each year dating back to 1987. And you see progressively as the years go forward that the vast majority are key TAM actions and not actions that were initiated originally by the government. Again, and this is showing the recoveries. I mean, it's really staggering how the recoveries themselves, which are in red on your screen, far, far outnumber and outweigh the recoveries in non-QTAM actions. This is recoveries in QTAM actions where the U.S. declined intervention compared to total recoveries. So you can see there is a very small number there in red, and most of those, I would say, involved retaliation. So where the government declined, the plaintiff or the former employee decided to pursue the case, but pursued the case only based on retaliation. They still had a good amount of recovery in there. So now let's talk about the actual elements of retaliation as they stand now after those amendments in 2009. This is the statutory language itself. It's at 31 U.S.C. Section 3730H1. And that says an employee, contractor, or agent shall be entitled to all relief necessary to make that employee, contractor, agent whole if they are discharged, demoted, suspended, threatened, harassed, or in any other manner discriminated against in the terms and conditions of their employment based on lawful acts done by them or associated others in a furtherance of an action under this section, the False Claims Act section, or other efforts to stop one or more violations of the subchapter. And that's the big piece that was added on as far as the language goes after the 2009 amendments. It's that or other efforts to stop one or more violations. Prior to those amendments, that language wasn't there. And that essentially just meant that it would be that they were looking for somebody who was taking action that made it clear to their employer that they were pursuing or were could potentially pursue a False Claims Act case. That's no longer the standard. The standard after the 2009 amendments is that either they're made it clear that they're pursuing a False Claims Act case, or they are engaging in some effort to stop one or more violations of the False Claims Act, right? So they don't have to know that they are pursuing a potential False Claims Act case, or they don't even need to look like they are necessarily pursuing a case. They just have to be able to show that they were attempting to stop a violation itself. So breaking down the elements. First, the whistleblower engaged in a, quote, protected activity. Two, the employer was aware that the whistleblower was engaged in a protected activity. And three, the whistleblower was subjected to an adverse employment action because they engaged in that protected activity. Who qualifies for a whistleblower? We just read the statutory language. It can be pretty much anyone you're coming into contact as a course of a business. It can be your employers. It can be any contractors that you might have or any agents that you might be working for or working with or are working at least on your behalf. Who can be held liable for retaliation? Again, it's pretty simple. Any employers or organizations that are working with contractors or agents or obviously have employees. The general rule as of right now is that individual employees supervising a whistleblower cannot be held liable. But the thing that's important that you need to remember is that your supervisors who engage in any type of retaliation against an employee for engaging in protected activity will create liability for the employer itself, even if the employer doesn't necessarily sanction the supervisor's conduct. So for example, if the supervisor demotes the employer without telling anybody else, or demotes the employee without telling anybody else at the company, and they're doing it because the person is complaining about potential false or fraudulent behavior, that action by the supervisor will be imputed to the company. So what is protected activity? That's really the baseline where we need to start here. An individual must be engaged in activity that could reasonably lead to, one, a claim that the government was billed fraudulently or there was some other type of false claims or actions taken, or two, stopping a violation of the FCA. Those are the two kinds of protected activity that must exist. A whistleblower's activity must be related to a suspected fraud on the government, which includes either investigating suspected fraud, attempting to stop suspected fraud, or refusing to participate in suspected fraud. So those are the three areas that we're looking at, and as to whether somebody is actually engaging in protected activity. Some more on protected activity. General complaints about the quality of an employer's goods or services are not going to be sufficient, all right? So just a general complaint about not being able to meet certain standards of work, or not thinking, or that the employer's products are not up to snuff. Without those things alone, without anything more, is not going to be sufficient to be considered protected activity. But a whistleblower is not required to uncover actual fraud. They only need to have a reasonable suspicion. And that reasonable suspicion, that's not necessarily a subjective thing. There does have to be some objective standard that you can look at to say this person is engaging, or this company is engaging in fraud or not. It can't just be some out of the blue, something not rooted in fact. There has to be some factual basis to them having a reasonable suspicion. But again, they don't have to actually uncover fraud. They just have to believe that you're engaging in fraud and be able to show that that suspicion was reasonable. So the real relevant inquiry here when determining whether actions are going to be protected activity or not, it comes into two categories. Number one, whether the employee in good faith believed that there was this conduct going on. And two, whether a reasonable employee in the same or similar circumstances might have believed that the employer was committing fraud or engaging in false claims against the government. So the next element then is that the employer has to be aware that the employee engaged in protected activity, right? If there's no awareness, then there can't be a link between any adverse employment action maybe taken later on and the protected activity. The employee has to show that the employer knew that protected activity had been engaged in. So that can come in a variety of ways. You know, it can be through just emails and memos that the person might be sending internally. Maybe it's phone calls they're making to either a hotline or to the compliance department, whatever it might be. And it can also come through in-person meetings. If they're making complaints verbally to their supervisor, to somebody else at the company, that can stand for knowledge after they've made their complaint that the company now is aware of the protected activity. Again, though, knowledge or notice is going to be viewed from the perspective of a reasonable employer, whether a reasonable employer would have been aware that a whistleblower is investigating possible fraud on the government. And one of the tricky pieces here comes when an employee is someone who is tasked with investigating fraud or making sure that the company is complying with government regulations and statutes. So in a lot of cases, and we're going to talk about this a little bit more as we get into the presentation further, but in a lot of cases you have, for example, a compliance officer who makes a claim for retaliation, even though they were the ones who were supposed to be making sure that the company was doing what they were supposed to be doing. So when that employee makes any reports about failure to comply or issues that need to be dealt with in order to come into compliance, the big question is that truly protected activity, or are their complaints actually putting the employer on notice when they were the ones who are supposed to be dealing with fraud or compliance in the first place? So that gets into a little bit trickier of a situation and makes it for a much harder claim for a plaintiff to make. Which is, so this is the notice dilemma that I was just talking about. there is a heightened notice presumption that's going to apply to those kinds of people, where their job responsibilities essentially include either preventing fraud or investigating fraud, anything like that. They're going to have a heightened presumption to get over as far as notice being provided to the employer. So these individuals whose jobs entail investigation of fraud, they're going to have to do something more than just a regular employee to make clear that they are either attempting to bring or assisting in bringing an FCA action in order to overcome the presumption that an employee, that they're merely acting in accordance with their employment obligations. And, you know, from my perspective, the additional piece that was added to the language of the statute on either working to stop one or more violations of the False Claims Act, really, it almost becomes impossible for somebody who is either engaged in fraud prevention or compliance, whatever it might be, it almost becomes impossible for them to meet that standard, the stopping one or more violations of the FCA, because that is their job. They would have to show, essentially, that not only were they doing their job by stopping a violation, but that they were somehow thwarted from stopping that violation, or that stopping that violation led to some sort of retaliation down the road. So that, and that's going to be a very hard standard for somebody in that position to meet. But at the end of the day, that application of that heightened notice presumption is going to require a very fast, specific inquiry. You're not going to have any cut and dry line as this is notice and this is not notice. It's really going to depend on what the job was, what their job responsibilities required, and what steps they took to stop a violation or pursue an action to prevent a violation, and then what was done as far as an adverse employment action in relation to their actions in stopping or preventing an FCA violation. It's really a fact-specific inquiry that we can't really put a bright line as far as this is or is not sufficient notice in those kinds of cases. So the next element of the false claims retaliation case is the causation element. And that essentially says that retaliation is unlawful if it is done because of a whistleblower's protected activity, right? So for example, if you have an employee who engaged in protected activity who's later terminated for attendance issues, there's a unlikelihood that that was done because of the protected activity. But you need to be careful as to how far you want to push that envelope and making sure that if you do have a legitimate reason or basis for terminating somebody outside of the protected activity, that it's been well documented. And obviously, if it's documented prior to the protected activity, that's particularly helpful. There are some courts out there that require showing that the employer's adverse action against the whistleblower would not have occurred but for the whistleblower's protected activity. That is a very strict standard for a plaintiff to meet. That's not the general rule that most courts look at today. Most courts look at today the same kind of standard as any other employment retaliation case, which means that liability is going to be imposed if this adverse action that's taken is somehow motivated, at least in part, by the whistleblower's protected activity. And so some of the things they're going to be looking at is the timing of it, of the termination. And, you know, is the person engaged in protected activity and 2 weeks later they're terminated? Some employers are a little surprised by how long of a period courts will consider as far as the timing goes when looking at whether or not the action is suspect. Most courts are going to say that if some action is taken within 3 months of the protected activity, there's going to be some sort of inference that it was done because of the protected activity. So that, of course, you know, for employers makes it very important that if there's any brewing disciplinary action or disciplinary problems, performance issues, attendance problems that were brewing for a particular employee, it's always important to document those things contemporaneously with when they're happening. Because, you know, if you have somebody who has attendance problems and you let that go on without being documented or disciplined, and then they had some sort of engage in some sort of protected activity, and then you decide to fire them, the court is going to infer from that that you likely would not have fired the person for that attendance issue or disciplined them otherwise for that attendance issue until they engaged in the protected activity. They're also, the other big thing that courts are going to look at is shifting rationales. So if you give one reason for why the person is being terminated at the time of termination, and maybe you have some internal documents that say something else, and then you get to litigation and you come up with a different reason for why they were terminated, the court's going to look at that and find that obviously suspect, that you're not keeping a straight story as to why this person has been terminated. So, you know, if you're going to terminate somebody, particularly somebody who's already engaged in protected activity, it a lot of times it's important to get legal counsel involved to make sure that you're all on the same page and that you keep a consistent story as far as why the person is being terminated. So types of retaliation, again, the same kinds of retaliation we're looking at in any employment case: termination, demotion, suspension, threats, harassment, or any other kind of discrimination. And it doesn't necessarily have to be straightforward. It could be, you know, some examples here on the slide: denying a leave request, scheduling the employee for fewer hours, maybe if they work shifts, excluding the employee from certain meetings or projects, or even applying a higher level of scrutiny to the employee or her work compared to others at the same level. So those are all the things. Those aren't necessarily overt types of retaliation, but there are things you want to keep on the lookout for and make sure that anybody who's engaged in supervising that employee is not participating in that kind of behavior. So the burden shifting analysis, once you do get to litigation on this kind of retaliation, is similar to any other kind of discrimination or employment cases. First, the plaintiff has the initial burden to establish a prima facie case of retaliation. That means they have to show, at least allege, that there was protected activity, that there was an adverse action taken against them, and that there was a connection between the protected activity and the adverse action. Once they present facts showing those three things, then the burden shifts to the employer, where the employer then is going to be expected to produce evidence of a legitimate, non-retaliatory reason for the adverse action. For example, attendance issues. If the person's been having attendance issues for more than a year now, and we've been disciplining the person, and so this termination was just in the line with our progressive disciplinary policy. You'd have to present something like that. And then finally, if the employer is then able to produce evidence of a legitimate reason, the burden's going to shift back to the plaintiff, who's then going to be expected to prove with actual evidence that the reason provided by the employer is not the real reason, but a pretext, a fake reason for the retaliation taken. Some just general factors considered in suggesting retaliation. Again, there's timing. The adverse action is taken relatively soon after the employee engaged in a complaint. The adverse action follows an earlier history of the whistleblower's favorable job evaluation. So if the person has stellar performance evaluations for 3 years, they engage in protected activity, and all of a sudden they get a negative evaluation, that's going to look suspect. There's also shifting rationales, like we just discussed, for the adverse action itself. So you want to make sure that what you tell the employee and what you write about the employee internally, and then later on what you put forward to the court as the reason for the action, are all on the same level. And then finally, the employer treats the whistleblower more adversely than similarly situated persons. So again, the person shouldn't be held to a higher standard as far as their performance goes than anybody else in their same job, position, title, whatever it might be. Activities you want to make sure you avoid. Obviously, engaging in retaliation against the person who files the complaint. You don't want to change their job status in any way without first having a valid reason for doing that. You don't want to establish a written record, or you want to make sure you do so with a written record. So you don't want to just take an action without having something to solidify or state the basis for it that's legitimate. So creating a written record of the change in their status is important. And then also, you don't want to alter their job status without first consulting legal counsel, because again, you want to make sure that what you are doing is not going to be viewed as retaliation, that it's going to have a legitimate basis, and that you're going to be able to defend that basis if you have to go to litigation down the road. So with all that, let's take a look at some cases that have come out recently on false claims retaliation. So the first, Carlson v. Dencorp International. Carlson alleged that he questioned certain of the company's practices of underbilling the government, so underbilling, not overbilling, on existing contracts to enhance its competitive position on a new bid. So Dencorp had several contracts already with the government that this person alleged they were underbilling on in order to secure another bid that they were putting in for new work with the government. So he alleged that by doing that, he had engaged in efforts to stop one or more violations of the FCA. That's that piece of the language in the statute that was added after the 2009 amendments. And then after doing that, he says, or he alleged that he was terminated. So this case, coming out of the Fourth Circuit, affirmed the lower court's dismissal of Carlson's claim, stating that, quote, efforts to stop one or more violations constitutes protected activity where those efforts are, quote, motivated by an objectively reasonable belief that the employee's employer is violating or soon will violate the FCA. So the court asked, essentially, whether Carlson alleged facts sufficient to show that he believed Dencorp was violating the FCA, that his belief was reasonable, that he took action based on that belief, and that his actions were designed to stop one or more violations of the act. And the court ultimately determined that Carlson could not ever be able to present sufficient factual allegations to suggest that Dencorp made or was about to make a false claim, because the claim that he was making was that they were underbilling the government. And there's no law, including under the False Claims Act, that considers underbilling the government to be a fraud on the government or a false claim against the government. If they wanted to underbill the government, that is certainly their prerogative and would not be the basis for a False Claims Act claim. Next comes this case against Mid-South Heart Center. It was by a cardiologist. I'm going to probably butcher his name, but Fakariti was hired as a cardiologist by this clinic. And a dispute arose about how an account that had been established on his behalf to supplement his collections was being funded. And so as a result of that, he requested a complete audit of the clinic's financial practices. And after several weeks of kind of going back and forth with the clinic on his audit request, he was then terminated. He ended up filing suit alleging that he was terminated in retaliation for his efforts to prevent violations of the FCA. So in this case, he never actually filed a False Claims Act case or claim. He just went right with a retaliation under the False Claims Act. And this was coming out of the Western District of Tennessee. The federal court there granted the cardiology clinic's motion to dismiss. And in doing so, they found that the employee's request for an audit did not constitute protected activity. And that's because none of his initial reports to those in authority at the clinic or the hospital alleged any kind of fraud. Instead, the court found that his allegations revealed nothing more than an attempt to minimize his personal financial liability under his employment agreements with the clinic, and that they were not in any way related to an effort by him to stop an FCA violation. Next, we have Ickes versus Next Care Health System. And in that case, Ickes made internal complaints about NextCare's practice of discharging patients on the basis of a change in insurance payer from Medicare to Medicaid. And Ickes alleges that after making those internal complaints, he was fired. NextCare filed a motion to dismiss with the court and argued that Ickes' complaints did not amount to protected activity because compliance with healthcare regulations was only a condition of participation and not a condition of payment. So essentially, because it had nothing related to making claims on the government or asking for payment from the government, then it could not be protected activity under the False Claims Act. So this was a decision that came out of the U.S. District Court for the Eastern District of Michigan. They actually denied NextCare's motion to dismiss and found that Ickes' effort could be viewed as efforts to stop one or more violations of the False Claims Act. The court held that the act protects an employee who is punished for his or her efforts to stop violations of the False Claims Act. Its protections are not limited to only those employees whose complaints turn out to prove a violation of the False Claims Act by a preponderance of the evidence. Such an interpretation would afford little protection for whistleblowers who are not FCA experts and are only able to report what they suspect to be fraud or misconduct. So that's really, that's a good comparison for Feccarini, where he alleged that he engaged in protected activity, but the court in that case found that it was unreasonable for any employee to have believed that they were engaging in protected activity by making those audit requests about their own account that was being maintained by the clinic. Whereas in this case, even if what Ickes was complaining about was not an actual violation of the FCA, he had a reasonable belief because he is an everyday person who's not an expert in false claims. And so that reasonable belief was enough to put the employer on notice that he had made a complaint. And so any termination of him after or as a result of making that complaint is considered retaliation. Next, we have Singletary versus Howard University. In that case, Singletary was an attending veterinarian at Howard School of Medicine and was responsible for the custody and care of the animals kept by the school. Singletary alleged that she made several internal complaints to the school that the conditions in which the animals were kept did not meet government regulations, and she reported a single incident regarding animal care to the NIH. She then alleged that she was later terminated as a result of both her internal complaints and the external report that she made to the NIH. In that case, it was coming out of the District of Columbia. The federal court held that as the attending veterinarian at the school, Singletary was responsible for reporting issues related to the conditions in which the school's animals were kept. And because she had such a position, the burden was on her to overcome that heightened pleading or notice standard that we talked about earlier. So she was responsible, essentially, for caring for the animals, making sure that there were anything that was unresolved or needed to be dealt with was, in fact, dealt with, so that way the care of the animals could be up to the standards required by the law. And so in granting Howard's motion to dismiss the case, the court ended up finding that Singletary had not engaged in protected activity because she failed to overcome that presumption. It was clear to the court that she was merely acting in accordance with her employment obligations. So that was, again, that heightened pleading or notice standard that we were talking about earlier. Now this one comes out a little bit different. This is McHale versus Walgreens. And in this case, McHale was a staff pharmacist at Walgreens who raised concerns about potential Medicare fraud by reporting suspicious prescription numbers to her supervisor. She then alleged that she was terminated after raising those concerns. Walgreens, after going all through discovery, filed a motion for summary judgment, but the court denied that motion, holding that McHale engaged in protected activity when she reported potential Medicare fraud and rejected Walgreens' argument or attempt to rely on the heightened notice presumption, stating that it was no longer applicable after the 2009-2010 amendments. This is a really scary decision, obviously, because if you have individuals in your employment who are expected to make sure that the company is in compliance or make sure that they're not engaging in any fraud, and that's part of their job, your expectation is that they would come forward to you, the employer, with any issues that needed to be dealt with in that regard. And so if they're coming forward with those issues, to consider that to be protected activity could potentially put there in any action they take under their job to be protected activity. So there, I would say that this is not the majority view of most of the courts, but there are several courts out there that follow this line of thinking, that even if it's part of the individual's job responsibilities and obligations, that doesn't mean they have to meet a higher standard. So it's important to keep that in mind when you do take any actions against an individual who might be in that kind of job, who has been raising concerns about potential fraud or false claims. So now let's get into how we are going to actually deal with whistleblowers and complaints. First question you need to think about is when to conduct an internal investigation. It's going to be warranted where there's allegations involve any type of widespread misconduct, misconduct by a senior manager or somebody higher up at the executive level, or violations of any state or federal statutes are going to be implicated if their complaints are indeed considered found true. A prompt investigation is going to be particularly important where government scrutiny is at least possible. If you think there's a potential for the government to find out about this and step in, then it's going to be important to show that you took steps to investigate the complaint itself once you found out about it. Ignoring complaints could lead to disgruntled employees becoming a whistleblower. So that means if an employee who not otherwise would have been taken anything to the next level, if they complain about something and they believe that they weren't being heard or nothing was dealt with in any way after their complaint, that could turn them into a whistleblower. An internal investigation is also going to provide you, the company, with really critical information early on. It's going to allow you to gather the best information. Your witnesses are going to have the most fresh recollection of what happened or didn't happen. You're not going to run into the problem of potentially losing documents or having documents be deleted before you have a chance to collect them and review them. So it's really important to do investigations promptly because of that. And the faster, essentially, the facts are learned, the greater chance you're going to be able to have to minimize any negative consequences that could come about later on down the road. You know, one of the questions I get most often from employers is, you know, how do I know that what I'm hearing from an employee is actually a complaint? How do I spot it? And it is tough sometimes. It can be tough because most employees are not coming to you with an overt, I have a complaint about fraud. So not all complaints, frankly, should trigger an investigation are easy to identify. But you should be looking at a lot of areas, not just the times when employees are coming to you directly, but maybe look at exit interview comments, people, you know, things that they tell you happened while they were still employed. If you're overhearing rumors or comments about some inappropriate behavior, you know, some of those should at least be looked into to make sure that it's just a rumor, not something more. And then same thing for informal comments about relationships. What you might take as an offhand comment might actually be something bigger than what it seems to be on its face. Discussing some more benefits of a prompt internal investigation. It's going to demonstrate that you engaged in a good faith attempt to identify or fix whatever was brought forward to you. It's going to allow you to take the necessary remedial actions or even make self-disclosure if that's going to be applicable to you. Those remedial actions or self-reporting could potentially minimize any penalties you might face, whether that's by the government. I mean, one of the best things you can say to a government investigator is, the minute I found out about it, the minute we learned of the complaint, we investigated, we took action, and these are the steps that we took as a response to the investigation. That's going to go a long way with the government. And it'll also go a long way with defending any retaliation claim you might have down the road. And ultimately, the negative consequences of not conducting an investigation could actually increase your penalties with the government, could create greater liability for retaliation. So you need to keep all of that in mind. There are some red flags when you need to call outside counsel, you know, and it could be even not just when the complaint, but once the investigation gets rolling. Anytime you have potential criminal liability, you want to call counsel. Any allegations made against senior management or your board, systemic or wide-ranging issues spanning an extended period of time, financial risk to the organization is going to be high, right? So if it's kind of like the bet the company type of claim, you definitely want to have outside counsel come in as soon as possible. If you think there might be any type of collateral litigation that could be filed as a result of any of the issues that are involved in the complaint or the investigation, outside counsel should be brought in to make sure you're protecting yourself both in that investigation and in the collateral litigation. And, you know, in-house interviews that are conducted by members of the company itself are just going to be considered business in nature, and those are subject to production and discovery. Whereas if you have an attorney conducting any type of investigation or engaging in interviews, those might or might not be privileged, but at least you have somebody overseeing you that could have a privilege or have the investigator's notes or communications with the attorney privilege. So you need to keep privilege issues in mind as you're engaging in any type of investigation. So FCA investigations generally, they're going to be initiated by the government after a key TAM lawsuit is filed generally, and they're going to be filed under seal by the whistleblower. So the whistleblower files a lawsuit, the lawsuit is filed under seal, and the the federal government, the state government, whoever it might be, is then going to have an opportunity to investigate the claims and determine whether or not they want to intervene. From there, you're going to have the Department of Justice is going to issue a civil investigative demand on the company while the case is under seal, so you're not going to necessarily know that a complaint has been filed or who filed the complaint, but you might get this demand for information and allows them to get documents, take depositions, issue interrogatories, all sorts of discovery. And then the company, your response to those requests are generally going to be how the Department of Justice decides whether or not to intervene in the lawsuit on behalf of the plaintiff or the relator. Your ultimate goal, obviously, in a government investigation of that type is to avoid them from intervening. So you ultimately want them to say, there's not enough here for us to intervene. Relator, go ahead, you can pursue the case on your own if you want to. So some tips for handling whistleblowers. You want to keep the whistleblower informed of the status of the investigation, right? You don't need to give blow-by-blow details, but at least make them aware that you're investigating, you're interviewing witnesses, you're looking at documents. You will keep them informed once the investigation comes to a close. You want to make sure that the person knows that his or her supervisors are not going to take any retaliatory action. And if there is some type of action taken against them, you want to make sure that they make you aware that that's happened, but also you want to make sure that the action was taken was valid and had a reason for being taken. Again, consult legal counsel before taking any adverse action against a whistleblower, period. I mean, even if you think it's the most, non-action, you want to make sure that you're doing it the right way at least. You want to make sure, in particular, that your supervisors are well trained on these issues. They need to understand what's protected activity, they need to understand what notice of protected activity is, and they need to know what constitutes retaliation and how to avoid it, because they are your front line. If they don't know and they're engaging in behavior that could put you in jeopardy of liability, then you know, you are kind of standing out there without a defense. So you need to make sure that your supervisors understand the implications for all of this and how to behave accordingly. There obviously are lots of risks for mishandling whistleblowers. An employer is going to be held liable to a whistleblower, like I said earlier, even if no fraud or false claims are ever found. It doesn't matter. If there's a reasonable belief that they are complaining about fraud or false claims, and then they complain, and then an action is taken against them, even if a False Claims Act was never, a False Claims Act lawsuit was never actually filed, they can still pursue the retaliation piece of it. And so that alone could incentivize a whistleblower to pursue False Claims Act allegations against his or her employer, with the expectation that they'd still have significant liability if they get a retaliation claim. So an adverse action taken against a whistleblower could lead to even increased scrutiny from the government regulators, but it's going to generally just make you liable whether or not the government comes and steps in or not. So just to give you some examples of what could happen, this is a U.S., this is Mooney versus Americare. And Americare was found liable for retaliation against the relator. Under the statute, the court was tasked with interpreting the back pay doubling provision, and the court noted there was an inherent tension in the statutory language, which provided that the victim is to be made, quote, whole, while also receiving an award of double back pay. The court ended up finding that the doubling damages prior to subtracting mitigation was appropriate, right? So in this case, Americare said that the court should subtract any mitigating damages or money first. Like, for example, if the person found a new job and was earning wages for at least a period of time after the alleged adverse action took place, that should be subtracted. That money should be subtracted from what the damages ultimately ended up finding in as far as back pay or front pay. And the court here found that doubling of the damages should be done before subtracting for mitigation, and that that was appropriate because an employee retaliated against is best made whole by recovering 2 times the amount of back pay under the statute, regardless of whether or not there were mitigating money amounts that could be used to lessen the damages ultimately owed by the company. So when you're doing an investigation, you want to make sure that you preserve documents during those investigations. It's essential to preserve those records because it's either going to be related to the DOJ's request for information or the subpoena, and it's also going to be relevant to the whistleblower claim that you're going to have to defend later on. The company has to take steps then to preserve both your electronic and your paper records. And that's going to be including on any company-controlled devices. So if you have employees with cell phones or laptops or tablets, you need to make sure that all of those devices are going to fall within any preservation efforts that you take to make sure that documents aren't destroyed. You want to inventory all potentially relevant documents and records. So you want to make sure that you know what the list is, what the universe is of those relevant documents and records that need to be protected. Because at the end of the day, and this is not just in false claims cases, this is in any litigation, there are significant negative consequences for you losing or altering records in court with the litigation, when you knew or should have known at least that you were supposed to be protecting them. So our best recommendation is to issue document hold notices. And these are legal documents that get issued to all record custodians, any person who you believe has emails, performance evaluations, personnel records, anything of that nature that might in some way be related to the employee's employment with the company or their complaint, you need to make sure that you identify those people and what documents they might have, and that you issue document hold notices to make sure that they keep those documents safe and protected, at least for the life of the investigation and potentially the litigation. In that notice, you want to make sure you specify what documents are supposed to be protected. You need to make sure that the employee who's getting the notice is warned of the adverse consequences to both themselves and the company if the documents aren't retained or they're allowed to be altered in some way. They should sign a notice acknowledging that, yes, I have received this document hold notice, I am going to keep these records, and I'm on notice and aware that I'm supposed to be doing these things. And then, you know, one of the things a lot of people forget, especially once litigation or investigations kind of lag on for long periods of time, you should be monitoring the compliance with your notice. You make sure that if you put a hold on any automatic deletion functions in your email, that stays that way throughout the course of the litigation, that it hasn't been switched back for whatever reason, or that people who had records or documents related to the employee, even 2 years later, if the litigation is still going on, you need to make sure that they still keep those documents and that they don't do anything with them or destroy them. So the big question, though, is you have a sealed suit, and it involves a whistleblower or retaliation allegation, but you have no idea who the plaintiff is, right? So if somebody, some employee, former or current of yours, files a sealed lawsuit alleging False Claims Act or alleging just a retaliation under the False Claims Act, but that claim is sealed to allow the government time to investigate. And in the meantime, how are you supposed to make sure you protect your documents or protect any data that's related to that employee? Kind of a nightmare scenario, right? For example, I have a suit where the lawsuit was filed under seal, alleging false claims and retaliation. The government spent 4 years investigating the claim. All the while, my client had no idea who the plaintiff was, who the relator was. And so it became awfully difficult to identify what documents to protect, what personnel records to protect and maintain for 4 years, especially when, you know, most states you don't have to maintain employment records for somebody who's no longer an employee for that long after they've left your employment. So you have to consider options as far as what you can do with HR for suspending any type of regular internal record retention policies or procedures. Because if your HR is really good about calling through their old personnel files for employees who no longer work for you, you want to make sure that they don't get rid of anybody's file who might be the one who has filed suit, because you'll no longer have access to those records once the suit is unsealed and you now have to defend a retaliation case without a copy of the person's personnel files. So you need to consider all options, particularly when you're dealing with a sealed suit, and how you're going to keep documents to later defend yourself if it's a retaliation claim that's included in the lawsuit. So with that, we've reached the end of our presentation. And it would, like I said, please keep, you can ask any questions you have. I'm also available. My email address is jcurry, C-U-R-R-Y, at bakerdonaldson.com. So if you have any questions you just want to ask me directly, please go ahead. Otherwise, thank you for joining me, and make sure you look out for the next invitation to our healthcare L&E webinar series that will be coming in May. Have a great rest of your day. Thank you.